Let's start the day. This week, as you would have noticed, last week we were focusing more on issues relating to security from an energy perspective, nuclear, coal, cyber, biological weapons, etc. This week, you have an equally interesting set of sessions. We are starting with the session on health. Later, we are discussing agriculture. And then afternoon, we are discussing maritime. Interesting set of discussions. As you would appreciate that the entire coursework, in fact, there was so much of a brainstorming into choosing these subjects. And also thanks to some of you for giving some more inputs on what could be other subjects. We'll keep that in mind for our future workshop. Now I'll request Dr. Surya Narayan to invite and introduce our speaker for the session, who will speak on science, technology, and health. Over to you, Dr. Narayan.
Good morning. I'm very happy and privileged to welcome one of the emeritus professor, Professor G. Padmanabhan. I know him when I did my MSc, PhD during that time through my senior professors. So Professor G. Padmanabhan was instrumental in using a recombinant DNA technology in our country. He showed that curcumin from turmeric, it's one of the spice, has antimicrobial activity and embedded on clinical trials to prove the efficacy of curcumin-based combination therapy for malaria. Professor Padmanabhan worked closely with several government agencies to further the cause of biotechnology in the country. He helped and promote the vaccine industry in our country and supported his colleagues in the development of recombinant hepatitis B virus vaccination and DNA rabies vaccination. He chaired several committees of the Department of Biotechnology. He was a part of several invitees to promote life science research. He was a member of WHO group on malaria for 3 years. Professor Padmanabhan received his BSc chemistry from College of Chennai, MSc in Social Science Agriculture Chemistry from Indian Agriculture Research Institute, New Delhi, and DSc Honours from BHU, Banaras Hindu University, and PhD from Biochemistry in 1966 from the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. He went to become a director IIC during 1994-98. For his contribution, I'm happy to share this. Professor Padmanabhan was conferred with the SS Bhatnagar Prize in 1983, one of the prestigious awards that Padma Sri in 1991, and the Padma Bhushan in 2004 from the Government of India. He is also instructed in Indian philosophy and confirmed music. With these few words, I request Dr. Padmanabhan to deliver his very good talk on science, technology, and health. So,
thank you, Dr. Surya Narayana, for the introduction. Let me thank Niyas, Dr. Baldev Raj, Dr. Subhash Chandran for asking me to participate in this workshop. I slightly modified the title saying science technology in health rather than and health. As a laboratory scientist, we get lost in our own technologies, devices, drugs which we develop. Many times the larger perspective of health, we are not very familiar. You know, we think we have developed something and it should reach the people, because I have been on both sides of the spectrum. And I know what it is to take something from the lab to the land. And especially in health, there are many, many challenges which scientists like me generally are not aware of. So I thought I will have a few slides, maybe 4 or 5 slides, giving you the general perspective of health. This is essentially based on Deloitte. It's a professional services firm. They have a very nice review on 2015 Global Healthcare Outlook, Common Goals, Competing Priorities. Now, if you really look at the issues in developed countries, is essentially It's because they have a public healthcare system almost completely covered. So they are always worried about out-of-pocket expense, as they call it. It keeps increasing. Government is not able to cover the expenses. So it's more commercially oriented concerns, essentially because the cost of drugs is increasing. They have huge increase in the chronic diseases, whether it is cancer, whether it is diabetes. You know, these are all diseases for which you have to take drugs for a lifetime. And therefore, they are more worried about health plan and things like that. But when you come to a developing country like India, we hardly have any public healthcare system. You know, 70% is what we call as out-of-pocket expenditure. But this is a standard term used, OOP, but actually it means you shell out for your health. So 70% is on that. Hardly public sector companies, government covers, DHS and so on. In addition, we have huge problems, both communicable and non-communicable disease. It is not as if we have only infectious diseases, communicable diseases. We are also the capital of diabetes in the world. So chronic diseases also affect us. Cancer is increasing. So India has a big challenge both in terms of communicable as well as non-communicable diseases. In addition, because of the levels of literacy, exploitation, spurious drugs, self-medication, fake therapies, because 70% of the population, or even more, is dependent on what we call as natural therapies, herbals, Ayurveda. The science may be okay, but, who are the practitioners? What is it they are getting? Every village has a system? Are these people qualified? We have huge problems. So huge personal expenditure is huge. I mean, comparison is 70% India, Thailand 25, China 44, Sri Lanka 55. That means they do seem to have a slightly better public healthcare system. Now, in further challenges in India, at the same time, India does want to increase its concern as a governmental system. They want to reach out to people. You have want to improve use of essential medicine, want to expand immunization. The biggest issue with children, child health, is probably immunization. If you can protect them against 8 to 10 diseases, you can create protection against mortality. Although we have increased, I think at the time of independence, we were something like 32% life expectancy. We are 63% life expectancy today. But that's not enough. Developed countries are 80 plus. Of course, the increased life expectancy comes with its own issue. We'll maybe touch upon it at some point of time. So the government is also concerned, essential medicine, expanding immunization, modernizing public hospitals, tobacco control program. It's not a trivial issue at all. I don't know, millions will die of consuming tobacco, one way or the other, but I don't think it is still that seriousness has crept into the people, actually. This will reduce our, what we call as OOP, we're still a long way off. At the same time, you have another, India has very, very, very peculiar kind of environment. On the one hand, you have very classic approaches to medical tourism. You have very high-end technologies are available. Middle East countries and others do come to India, or even developed countries, people come to India for therapy. There's the issue whether we should be promoting medical tourism. You look at the other side of the picture, you have how many doctors per thousand? You have 3.3 doctors per thousand in the US. In India, we have 0.7 per thousand. Look at how many hospital beds we have. USA has one in out of 350. Japan, for one hospital bed out of 85 population. And India has got one in 1,050. So we have to invest a huge lot to improve infrastructure. Now, at the same time, there's a tremendous opportunity that has come to India in terms of export and so on. This is in the field of generic drugs. For those who are not in the field, generic drugs, essentially drugs which are out of patent. And India, I know, is capable of making these drugs much, much cheaper. And you might remember the classical example of HIV therapy. When it initially it was introduced, it cost a huge lot of money. Nobody could afford. Cipla came up and said, I can provide it at one-tenth the cost. And everybody tried to criticize, these are all bogus drugs, spurious drugs, nobody should take. And eventually Cipla take over. The entire African belt has been supported by drugs from companies like Cipla. And today, India has become a big force in generic drugs. And slowly what has happened, developed countries, because of their out-of-pocket expenses increasing, they are now permitting generic drugs. Now in the United States, for example, according to this report, almost 70% drug is now generic drug. It's not branded drugs anymore. Therefore, here, India has a huge opportunity. You know, therefore, of course, there are issues like protection. These countries do not like. Many times they will take action. Many times it is political. People do not know. They think our drugs are spurious. Of course, we are capable of making spurious drugs also. But at the same time, you know, there are many angles to it. Now, before I get into the science and technology part, I want to tell you tremendous many things are happening in India in terms of devices, in terms of developing molecules, in terms of developing newer vaccines. But all these come with a price tag. Now, we have a challenge of not only making, fantastic, keep pace with the science and technology, but we also have to make affordable. That is where biggest challenge, as a scientist, I have felt all my life, and many, everyone feels that. However, the high cost of targeted therapy, personalized medicine, genetic-based medicine, medical devices add to the health care cost of burden. So this is the technology part which we will very briefly look into it. Now, how has biotechnology contributed to the whole scenario? Why I'm concentrating on biotechnology, not because of my familiarity, but also if you really look at the health sector, every department concerned with health has been looking at public health, you know, looking at data collection, looking at epidemiological data. Many times you do not find them really going after developing newer molecules, newer devices. That is not happening. For example, they will be doing a clinical trial to validate a drug that is available abroad. So I have challenged them many times, are you developing drug? You say, no, it's not possible. That scenario is changing today in India. Thanks to departments like biotechnology, science and technology, other including Indian Council of Medical Research, support systems have become made available to systems. And why I'm highlighting BIRAC? BIRAC stands for Biotechnology Industry Research Assistant Council. This is a paradigm shift because almost, formally this was done almost 3-4 years ago. It's a Section 25 or Section 8 company of the Department of Biotechnology. It's the first time in the history of a government department that they could float a company with all the privileges that are available to a company, because all along, system, whether it is DST, whether it is DBT, or whether any of these have been supporting academic community, which in a way has built the competence, no doubt about it. But it has never reached the people, or very rare examples by which you see things have reached the people. So the government decided, should we be supporting industry directly? This happened almost 9 or 10 years ago. SBIRA stands for Small Business Innovative Research Initiative. This is actually essentially copied from the United States, adapted to the Indian condition. This is available. Small businesses, can we support directly the industry? It's very interesting what has happened. Of course, the formally BIRAC came only four years ago, but I have been with this system almost 10 years ago. Today, this BIRAC has several programs under which something like, I think this is updated, 400 projects in 300 industries are being supported. Out of which 60% is in the health sector. And that is where the science and technology is happening. And interestingly, what is happening, the industries are now finding, if they have to really make innovate, they have to collaborate with the academic community. We have always been pushing the academic community, you are not collaborating with the industry. It never happened, or very rare examples. Today is the other way around. The industry is running after the academic community because they promised innovation. Many times you see innovation is happening in the academic community, but they don't know what to do beyond publishing the paper. They will publish the paper and forget about it and make a PhD out of it. But today, this is a revolution that is happening in India. I just want to one example of Bairac. Now it is linked up with all systems in India, abroad, because many ministries in India as well as agencies outside the country are very attracted to this Bairac model. Now, with this background, I just want to see what are all the technologies that are having impinging an influence on health. You know, I'll take one of them, each one. Biogenerics. We are global leaders in vaccines today. Emphasis on herbals, natural products. Innovation in diagnostic devices, medical instrumentation, mobile health and telemedicine, wearable technologies, big data analytics, 3D printing, artificial intelligence, synthetic biology, stem cell therapy, gene therapy. I could have added more, but I should finish in time. So quickly, I will discuss each one of these, where we are. Vaccines and biogenerics. Now, generics are different from biogenerics. I just want to clarify. The generics means it applies to drugs. Drugs are small organic molecules. Biogenerics are biomolecules. Today, proteins have become drugs. Nucleic acids have become drugs. And there also, patents are expiring. And therefore, India has a great opportunity. Just as they got into generic, they are also getting into biogenerics. Just a few examples. We have bacterial vaccines, viral vaccines, polysaccharide vaccines, recombinant vaccine. As Satyanarayana said, you know, we were involved in hepatitis B, recombinant hepatitis B vaccine. At the same time, as Shanta Biotech, some of you would have heard, made this vaccine in Hyderabad. We were probably behind 1 year, but the impact of this is important. Hepatitis B vaccine was known 15 years before we developed in India, but it still made a huge impact. Shanta's products, our products were given to 3 companies, all of them in Hyderabad. Yes, vaccine that was selling at 475 rupees a dose, UNESCO was trying to buy from India for 20 rupees a dose for to be distributed to African countries. This is what India can do. It's not as if, you know, recombinant hepatitis B vaccine is a great technology. For a molecular biologist, it is child's play. But the fact is, it can have our companies are so shrewd, my only concern with our companies is suddenly they compromise on quality. And, you know, people catch them and then all companies are bad. There are articles in Nature which I was deeply concerned. They analyzed 10 different, because so many companies have started making hepatitis B vaccine today. And they analyzed 10 samples from different companies, supposed to contain 10 microgram per ml. Some of them contained 1 microgram, and one of them didn't contain hepatitis B at all. This is enough. One example is enough to destroy our image in this whole world. And this is a thing which we need to worry. Anyway, I must tell you, India is exporting vaccines to 150 countries. Now, what is the challenge in vaccines, for example? We have to make modern vaccines. We are still good at classical vaccines. Diphtheria, tetanus. As our children grow, we would have given them all these triple injection, et cetera, et cetera. Now, one example, for example, HPV, cervical cancer. Cervical cancer, there are 2 vaccines available, HPV vaccines are available, very costly. Now, we are trying to make this in India, flu vaccines. Every year after year, we find dengue. Year after year, we find chikungunya. Year after year, we find influenza. It is not as if scientists are not working. These vaccines are made. Many times, you know, there are other systems. Suddenly, you will see imported from China. Didn't work. So there are issues other than science, technology, before these things really get into the market, actually. So some of the scientists who bear at it get frustrated, actually. Anyway, so these are challenges to make combination vaccines. As I told you, a child as it is growing up need to be protected against 8 to 10 diseases. And if you say a primary vaccination and a booster, it will come to some 36 times the child has to be pricked. It becomes a huge issue, actually. Therefore, there is a big research that is going on delivery systems. Without needleless delivery has become a huge issue. Don't poke the child. You know, there are, for example, there is a virus-like particle, oral, nasal, dermal patch. These sciences sometimes are not really familiar to a biologist. These are all coming. Many times you will see physicists, engineers are able to contribute better in some of these areas. Of course, the biological molecule will come from our research, which is what is happening. 50-well pneumococcal vaccine, these are all respiratory diseases. We still don't have proper vaccines for respiratory diseases. So these are all the challenges. Therefore, one of the challenges to have protection against cold chain. Storage of vaccine is becoming a big issue in village setting and so on. 4 degrees has to be, many times you have to store in the refrigerator. Therefore, a lot of research technology is being acquired to make these vaccines stable at room temperature or even at temperature as 40 degrees. Another thing that is happening is combination vaccines. Can we combine? That is why you see pentavalent vaccine, hexavalent vaccines. You know, you combine 5 vaccines and then inject. But you cannot arbitrarily combine 4 or 5 vaccines. You know, these are all proteins, they will all precipitate. So there is a lot of research is needed how to make the combination vaccines and so on. These are all some of the challenges that are happening. Vaccine is one sector. The other one is what we call as biopharmaceuticals. Again, I want to clarify, pharmaceutical means a drug, organic drug. Biopharmaceutical, these are all of the nature of proteins, mostly proteins, antibodies, insulin, erythropoietin, granulocyte stimulating factor, serum albumin, streptokinase, interferons, whole lot of monoclonal antibodies which are required for cancer therapy today. Very, very expensive. One example only because of time, I will not discuss all of them, just streptokinase. Streptokinase is the first shot you get in your myocardial infarction. When there is a blood clot, it has to be dissolved and the patient has to be immediately administered the streptokinase. So ImTech, Institute of Microbial Technology in Chandigarh, they have very good science they did. The streptokinase, first generation, second generation, third generation, now they have now globally competitive product they are trying to make. What they call it is a clot buster. The problem with streptokinase is it will dissolve the clot, but it will continue to act and degrade the cells. How do you control that? Now they are trying to do based on biochemistry that the enzyme will work only when the clot is there. When the clot is disappearing, then the enzyme will stop acting. Very beautiful concept actually. And you know, this has got into a huge, it is a CSR laboratory and it has given them a huge money, some 2-3 crores of agreement. Still, I do believe if it becomes a global product, it will be a blockbuster. But many of them, others are all monoclonal antibodies, etc. These are all biogenerics because they are all already known in the market. But the problem I find in India is at least 50 biogenerics we can make in India, like insulin, like monoclonal antibodies. We have made about 20 in this country. But for 20 biotherapeutics, we have 250 brands. Because our business sense takes over, you know, like paracetamol. How many companies will make paracetamol? So how many companies will make insulin? 40 brands of insulin, 55 brands of EPO. I mean, this is fair enough. When companies have to survive, they will do all kinds of things. But my feeling is, I keep pushing the people concerned, may go to the 21st biopharmaceutical, 22nd. We can make 50 of them. Now, new drug discovery is a very complex process. You will see, I don't know if you have followed the system, there is hardly any new drug that has been globally introduced. They estimated to introduce a new drug, it takes more than $1 billion. Extraordinarily expensive. So most of the drugs that are coming are biopharmaceuticals today, released into the market. They're all biopharmaceuticals than any new drug molecule. I'll come to the latter part later. That is, one of the reasons is, more science you put in, the complexity you understand. With all the modern technologies that are available, I will briefly explain maybe a little later, systems biology, for example. As a biochemistry teacher, I used to be teaching carbohydrate metabolism. Glucose is converted into glucose-6-phosphate by this enzyme hexokinase. It's a linear system we will be going all the way from glucose to carbon dioxide. We also used to be thinking one step, glucose 6 phosphate will become diphosphate, this, each enzyme. Now, with all the knowledge we now know, each enzyme is interacting with 100 other things. It is not as if it is an isolation, A is getting converted into B. There is an enzyme or an interaction with 100 other things, really. That is why if you look at cancer cell network, it has become extraordinarily complex. Therefore, if you target any step, it's not going to be adequate. And it is going to be virtually impossible to target so many. There, of course, we do hierarchies, and we try to lock out the hierarchical systems rather than bottom systems, or the downstream systems, as we call it. So you understand more of science, you now understand why a drug is failing. In addition to what we call as pharmacogenomics, at some point of time, we did not understand or didn't worry much about how an individual metabolizes a drug. I used to work on drug metabolism maybe 35 years ago, which means that, for example, aspirin, take Saridon. Some people will require 2 tablets, some people require 1/2 a tablet. This is all because of the potential of the system to metabolize, which varies from individual to individual. And this is gene-based. All the genes which are involved in drug metabolism have been identified today. And therefore, now what is happening, you cannot introduce a drug all the way and then find it is working only in this population, it is not working in this population. So it becomes a huge affair. Therefore, drug companies are now doing pharmacogenomics as they are developing the drug. Then, you know, as they do the trial, they will look at the metabolism profile of each individual and then say, no, it will not work in these individuals, it may work in these. I'm saying this because it's all adding to the cost of drug discovery. Therefore, this is systems biology, you know, component, biological cells, tissue, organ, ecological webs, it goes up the ladder. So, my own perception is what should India concentrate on? I feel in the drug sector, we should concentrate on natural products. We have a huge history of natural products history in this country. Plants, systems, hundreds of them. I just took some 10 of them, for example, anywhere between anti-aging, phytoestrogen, Parkinson's, irritable bowel, antimicrobial, there is some plant, some extract, described in literature. Practice also. We do not know the science behind many of these kinds of things. We don't know the science of Ayurveda, honestly speaking. Even in modern science, if you talk to them, they'll say they know a lot. In fact, I had a difficulty earlier. You know, we were trying to, for example, validate an Ayurvedic preparation against arthritis. So we were trying to bring, this was a project of CSIR, I and Dr. Valiathan from Manipal. We were trying to monitor this project and trying to bring the Vaids and the modern scientist and the Ayurvedic physician together and then see, what is your formulation? Can you compare it with a clinical trial where an allopathic drug is used? We did that. Of course, at the end of it, it didn't give us clear-cut lead anyway. But even assembling this group became a huge problem. People will say, why do you need all this? I already treated 1,000 people. The chief minister has given me a certificate. All this doesn't matter. See, anecdotal is not enough in the international community. You will ask, none of our drugs, Ayurvedic or any herbals, are sold as drugs abroad. They are all sold as nutraceuticals, food supplements. Chinese are able to sell their molecules as drugs. This is where, you know, we really need to go. And it's not as if herbals. We also have pure molecules identified over a period of time. You know, this is what he said. I've been struggling with curcumin. It's a pure molecule from turmeric. I should tell you there are more than 100 clinical trials known all over the world with curcumin. And you name the disease, somebody or the other has tested. But it is not a drug even for a single ailment. That is the reason I have been at it, taking it as an adjunct drug for malaria. Can I go all the way? Not only the science, we have published papers, we have patent. I want to do a clinical trial and establish and publish in something like Lancet or something, so the international community knows this is a molecule that works and based on hardcore modern science. And this is needed. I have given, there are hundreds of them. I am giving you a few examples. Methanolocytes for arthritis, cardiac glycosides, charantins, saponin, anti-diabetic, polyphenolics. My conclusion with natural products is, if it is herbal, it's fine, no problem. But we need to know, understand the mechanism of action at the scientific level, number one. Number two, preparations, standardization of the preparation. These molecules, these preparations will vary depending on the geography. If you read the literature, they will say you have to pluck the leaf at 12 noon. All those details are all given, but we don't know why did they say that. That means standardization of preparation based on fingerprinting. This is all people have understood these days. They're trying to make these things. But still, I find acceptance of this is not very easy at all. There's a prejudice in the Western mind to start with. On top of it, we cannot go on anecdotal examples. We have to give hardcore scientific basis. Now I go into some of the diagnostic devices, medical instrumentation, mobile health, wearable technologies, what impact they are making. Now, the huge lot of, we have looked at diagnostic projects, diagnosis of, I'm going to talk about molecular diagnosis. Clinical diagnosis is one aspect. None of the molecular diagnosis will work without clinical diagnosis. At the same time, clinicians are depending more and more on molecular diagnostics as an accompaniment, because there are lots of complexities that are coming. Therefore, you have ELISA, lateral flow, fluorescence readers. Basically, without getting into great details, I must tell you, the whole idea is to detect. Suppose I have malaria. Can I detect the malaria parasite? Malaria parasite has a DNA. Malaria parasite has proteins, which are different from the host. Can we detect them? So if you have an antibody, you can detect the protein. And polymerase chain reaction, specific primers can amplify only the malaria DNA, and then you can identify. Therefore, what has happened, the sensitivity of these processes have become extraordinarily high. I can detect one parasite today. People can detect one bacterium in blood. And this, the other one is, you know, chip-based analysis, fever chip, eye chip, sepsis chip, cancer chip. But chip means detecting the DNA, detecting the RNA which the bug is capable of making. Today, you can put sepsis, for example, it's a huge problem. People in ICU dying out of sepsis. And one finds there are usually 10, 15 organisms can be involved. And they will put each one of the DNA in a chip, 2 by 2 centimeter chip. Amplify each one of them and find out. This is called a sepsis chip. Similarly for cancer chip, these are all being developed in India. Right in Bangalore, there are companies which are making them, so the principle is the same, whether it's an infectious disease or whether it's a cancer. Identify the unique protein, identify the unique DNA, it is possible. And then comes the, these are all some of the products that are available. These are some of them developed by Dr. Naveen Khanna from ICGV Delhi, HIV detection, HBV detection, combinations and so on. To give you the exact fact, Jay Mitra in Mumbai is marketing this. Then to do a PCR reaction classically, that means to amplify a DNA, we used to have a big apparatus. Now whole thing becomes MEMS technology today. Now can you miniaturize the whole thing? Now what we have handheld PCR. Can you do the whole thing in a handheld system, in a field situation, take a prick, tiny amount of blood, can you do this analysis? It is possible. Right in Bangalore, a company has developed this micro PCR, as we call it, it's all done. But then that is not enough. The sensitivity has to be improved. ELISA, classically, color reactions are not enough. Can we add some more, improve the fluorescence? That is where quantum dots, nanotechnology, all these are becoming very important. Basically, what is this technology is about? You are adding an antigen, a protein, you are detecting with an antibody. And the antibody is decorated. You know, it takes a tag which gives you a color. Now, how sensitivity detection this color can be? If it is a fluorescence, if it is a nanoparticle based fluorescence, the sensitivity becomes very high. So these are all the things that are happening today. Terbium, europium, nanoparticle, these and those fields are, you can now see, these are all inorganic chemists who are talking about all these. Now they are getting into biology. They think if they put terbium or europium in these antibodies, you know, their fluorescent methods of detection is much, much higher. This is happening today in India. Well, HIV, another example I've given. So devices, I just will read what is happening, because I want to emphasize many times when I go to audiences, people don't know exactly what is happening in India. We think we are in the 18th century or something. It is not true. A lot of things are happening in India. For example, design development of photodynamic therapy laser system, image-guided interventional procedure with emphasis on oncology and pain care to be used by radiologists and so on. More examples, self-expanding percutaneous aortic valve technology, novel microfluidics-based flow analyzer, affordable fluorescence reader for point-of-care diagnostics, high-fidelity affordable mannequin for effective CPR, cardiopulmonary resuscitation, digital oncology slide scanner, cardiac markers using microcantilever technology. This is by IIT Mumbai students who are developing this. Retinal imaging device for retinopathy of prematurity, automated portable epilepsy. This has become commonplace. Flat panel computer tomography system, imaging device for monitoring breast tissue changes. This is a huge problem for breast cancer. Can we detect with mammography and so on much earlier possibilities of development? Wearable, I'll come to it in a minute. Mobile continuous ambulatory peritoneal dialysis. This will make a huge impact. They are trying to develop a dialysis machine as the patient can carry to his office and can undergo dialysis twice a day. Or three times, if I remember right. And they carry the thing with them, just like a backpack, you know, if the whole thing is being made. Interesting concepts. These are all getting developed. Fiber laser for photoselective tissue ablation. This is non-invasive. A novel device for screening newborns for hearing loss in resource-poor setting. So I can read, keep on reading. I took from 60, 70 examples, I took 15, 20 examples. Somebody tells me, the GE closed down their diagnostic division, all these people have started companies or something like that. But whatever may be the reason, newer and newer technologies are being developed. The challenge we will be having is, are these affordable? That will be eventually. The other area where there is a huge change that is taking place is mobile health. Using the cell phone technology, using the IT interface, now all these systems that are available, can you transport them through telemedicine? Now this has to be the route. India cannot have a health center in every village. It's going to be impossible. So, of course, the Deloitte analysis will be for the developed country. I'm not much concerned what is happening here. By leveraging the power and research reach of mobile communication, mobile health is making it possible to bring care to many rural, underserved parts of the world, such as China and Africa. Of course, it should be India as well. Care and monitoring that previously required a visit to a clinic or office can be managed remotely at home or work. Now, this is where telemedicine, according to even this analysis, telemedicine is a fast emerging sector in India. Several major hospitals have adopted telemedicine services and entered into public-private partnership. In 2012, the telemedicine market in India was valued at $7.5 billion. It is projected to rise to so and so. I'm not good at numbers, but you know, this is just to make an impact that it is not trivial anymore in India. Just two examples I want to give you of the projects. These are all young people. Many of them are IIT graduates, are just coming out of IIC, thinking of starting a company rather than rushing abroad. And see, just two examples I'm giving you. Mobile phone platform for blood glucose analysis. Software platform turns mobile phone into a diabetes monitoring platform, enabling lay users like health workers and patients to analyze blood glucose test strips using phone's camera, track symptoms and lifestyle data, and transmit data to your physician for follow-up. Very interesting, you know, that you can do everything, kind of collect the picture on the cell phone and transmit it. Rural primary health, another example, diagnostic service. This device uniquely combines automated microscopy, multi-wavelength colorimetry, and centrifuge with image processing techniques, dry chemistry, to suit the solution to the limited rural skill set and infrastructure. With the help of the device, a range of core tests will be addressed, including glucose, hemoglobin, differential blood counts, urinary tract infection, malaria, TB. Of course, maybe it's an overclaim, but things are happening. You can do all this in a rural setting with limited kind of training, get this information, transmit it to experts elsewhere, and see whether they can get access to help. And I feel these are areas which are you may not have seen an impact at this point of time, but these are all happening. Wearable technologies, you know, this is something, you know, you wear a belt and then being reminded of so many things. You know, of course, in the Western world, they are more worried about help them to track their moods to work, smoothly transfer or transmit data to doctors, doctors' records and so on. But in India, it is going to be a huge impact on the health sector. Of course, wearable sweat sensor paves way for real-time analysis of body chemistry. You know, you can have a belt which measures products in the sweat and then, you know, talks about the blood chemistry. Here also, you can see a couple of projects in India. Wearable belt to monitor fetal health. The pregnant woman wears this belt and constantly the from heartbeat to other few parameters, this belt monitors. Continuous monitoring of ECG, this has become commonplace. I met an individual from Bangalore who said, I have an environment sensor for asthmatics. You know, he has a belt, he has a cell phone, which is like he can wear it as a thing, and then it will measure, as you're driving, it will measure carbon dioxide in the environment. And pop-up will come the message, don't go to this area, you are asthmatic. So the thing that are happening is, really sometimes I find it is mind-boggling, you know, this is something. Additive manufacturing, I must confess, I don't know much about these areas, but these are all happening in these areas. This is what is called as 3D section, you know, to create a 3D object, you know, based on addition of layer by layer by layer software. It has many applications. It started with the metal use and so on. But in the medtech industry, at the forefront of this transformative change, medical applications account for about 1/6 of the artificial manufacturing, additive manufacturing market, or what we call as 3D printing. Now, right in our campus, you can see on designing tissues for drug screening in liver. You know, they have now made a chip which contains small bits of liver where you can screen drugs. You know, because you know drugs are most important organ in the body to metabolize the drug is the liver. Therefore, when somebody develops a drug, you have to screen against liver. Is it toxic? Is it metabolized? Now, using 3D printing, they are able to develop a chip, or probably slightly bigger than that, a panel where they have liver samples generated using this software knowledge, adding layer by layer by layer. They come to me because I worked on this area and then tell them, is your liver really liver? You know, does it have all the properties of liver? Because there are so many parameters that you need to establish before, say, I have made liver pieces by artificial printing. I'm just giving this example because they want to make kidney, they say, you know, you can have organ transplant, you can make it there. You know, young people have tremendous thinking process, so they want to make these things. But this is happening. Artificial intelligence is something I do not know. I'm not sure how much is happening. Some of you may know more. Though exponential increases in data, computing power, connectivity, miniaturization of hardware, and advanced software capabilities at lower cost, artificial intelligence will rapidly accelerate the development of next generation smart medtech devices and could cause profound disruption in the way healthcare is delivered in the future. I don't know, I have not followed up this literature, how much of artificial intelligence has been used in developing our medical devices. Another area of science and technology that has come in a big way is the big data analytics. We have now capable of analyzing huge amounts of data. You know, for example, you will know more, the detection of gravitational waves. I do not know how much of your data and analysis must have gone into that. This capability comes from our IT capabilities, actually, basically. This is where I really feel, you know, of course, in the Western country, it will for more efficient, robust business, clinical decision making, etc., etc. But in India, we are now using it to data mostly for diagnostic and DNA analysis. You know, that when you sequence organisms, the DNA is huge. Therefore, you need big data analytics to analyze this. That is what is used. But what I feel we need to be using is for public health. Anything you do in India, despite all that is happening, if you say, I work in malaria, you ask the government statistics, they will say 900 people died of malaria. 900 people died of malaria, probably in a single hospital. The rate of the death of malaria alone is up to 40 to 50,000 in India. That means we do not have proper statistics for anything. Cancer registry is there. That is where I feel. How many diabetics are there? What is the prognosis? What kind of molecules, drugs they are taking? How many are taking allopathic drugs? How many are taking homeopathic drugs? How are they performing? I feel that is where we need big analytics, data analytics for. It will give tremendous information in terms of population. This is where I think we need to use, in my perception. Of course, DNA analysis is okay. In the laboratory, people are using it, but it's still not being used in public health sector. Quickly on to synthetic biology. What is synthetic biology? I just want to give you a global view of what is happening in science. You know, this synthetic biology area was not conceived by biologists. It was conceived by a group of physicians and engineers. They thought, if a machine runs wire, transistors, valves, diodes, relays, electronic switches, can we have a biological machine? Can cells be treated as machines and run? And, you know, and what would be corresponding? It will be genes, RNA, proteins, transcription, translation. That means the whole reaction sequence is controlled by proteins, repressors, activators. How do you control the system? The only biggest challenge everybody is facing in synthetic biology is in a engineering machine, it is an enclosed system. There is no outside input there. Whereas in a biological machine, you may make all this. I can engineer an organism to produce unusual compound, let us say. A compound which is not known in nature, I can make today. But you put it into the biological system, there are millions of forces coming from outside. He is exposed to the environment. The engineer machine is not exposed to the environment. It runs in a closed system. Whereas, you know, in a living organism, you can introduce anything. It will be influenced by the environment within the cell. That is where the challenge is happening. But still, I should tell you, the companies that are getting into synthetic biology, I just gave you a number of biological systems designers, companies. This gives you 8 companies or 2 companies and the areas you will in synthetic biology, flavors, fragrances, paints and coatings, cosmetics, adhesives, lubricants, agrochemicals, not only drugs. So tomorrow science seems to be synthetic biology. It doesn't matter what chemical it is, what molecule is it, can you use synthetic biology? For which you need to understand the cell as a biological machine. How do you control this machine? And it has happened because of a crazy guy who introduced a genome from another organism to a related organism and converted this organism based on the DNA of the organism he introduced. Which means you can, anything unknown in nature, products can be made. You know, this is another way of representing cutting and pasting all the DNAs, bio big shots, how many companies are involved in this area. My own perception, take home, is there is a concern here. Are scientists trying to play God here? You know, you say you develop this, you don't know what you are doing. So this is one side of the argument. So already there is an international commission safety of synthetic biology. To my mind, it's much better, in my opinion, to modulate organisms and use them in a factory or something like that. With all there are today, you have BSL-1, BSL-2, BSL, just like nuclear establishment. Even in biological systems, you have lots of security concerns, and there are systems available. We call them as BSL-1, 2, 3, and so on. No bug can escape. So this kind of systems, it's new opportunities for biopharmaceutical production. This is a fungus. It's a yeast. Can you make, engineer the yeast in such a way it can produce different molecules that didn't exist in nature? It is possible today. But I find we are talking a lot about synthetic biology. We haven't done much in this country. We are still at the capacity building level, where we still have a long way to go. We haven't made a product, not a product. We don't even have a system. We don't understand. Many people talking about it, but we have not gone anywhere here. Similarly, a couple of examples I will give and stop. Gene therapy. What is gene therapy? These are all the highly futuristic areas, but the area is at least 30 years old. Why gene therapy? That basically, what is the simple definition for those in the field? Many diseases are gene-based. Not only genetic disorders, even infectious disease. Some people are prone to TB, some people are resistant to TB. There are certain genes, certain mutations. Can you replace a defective gene with a normal gene from outside? That is gene therapy, whatever is the mechanism. And there are processes available, and there are classical examples by which it was successful. But it has always been one step forward and two step backwards. What they developed somewhere, it didn't work in, and what works in the animal doesn't work in the human. You need, how do you introduce the gene? You use a vector, you use a virus to introduce the gene. Because the virus will go and infect the cell, but the virus itself, they disarm the virus so that it will not cause any disease. But in their anxiety, they dumped a lot of virus, and the patient died of virus infection rather than nothing to do with gene therapy. Once that happens, again, everything will be stopped internationally. Go to the blackboard, you have done something wrong. Your vector is not right. Develop new vectors. This has gone on for decades, decades and decades. Earlier, I used to be working in this area. But the last 4 or 5 years, tremendous progress has been made. Especially, this has become more or less regular therapy. Corneal disorders, hereditary blindness, REP gene, and lot of promises in hemophilia, thalassemia, Parkinson's, I won't still, immune deficiency, SCID was demonstrated. The most successful example demonstrated long back, actually. But I feel hemophilia and thalassemia. Thalassemic children, they are abnormal. There are several types of thalassemia, major, minor, beta thalassemia. They don't make the globin properly. One of the globins they do not make. And therefore, the children will not live for long. And how do you keep them alive? You have to give blood transfusion. And blood transfusion means, that means it will degrade and they accumulate a lot of iron toxicity. To remove the iron, you have to give a chelator. Therefore, it's a combination of a chelator as well as transfusion. Now, can you replace this defective globin with a normal globin? Looks like some promises. Similarly, hemophilic people, very expensive. But in India, again, we have been talking about gene therapy. Many times I remember the sentence, to run that much faster to stay where we are. We haven't done anything in gene therapy, we keep on talking. But it is not really an emerging field. It's been there for more than 30 years. But the potential is great. Similarly, the last example I'm giving is stem cell therapy. I'm sure you've heard about stem cell therapy. So much is being talked about stem cell therapy. What is a stem cell? Stem cell is a primordial cell in the body. It is this cell that gives rise to all other types of cells in the body. So an human embryo contains stem cells. Even the adult tissue also contains a stem cell. So you call it the embryonic stem cell, you call it the adult cell stem cell. The concept is whether you can give a stem cell, isolate the stem cell, expand the stem cell, and give the stem cell to replace degenerating neurons, for example. Can degenerating neurons can be replaced by fresh neurons by giving stem cell? But a classical example is bone marrow transplantation. That is the only example. You would have heard about bone marrow transplantation in leukemia. The way it works is because of stem cell in the bone marrow. But now claims have been made, it can be used for Parkinson's, it can be used for all kinds of disorders, but absolutely there is no proof. Hundreds of papers have been published. Everything is in trial mode. But unfortunately, in a country like India, people are already advertising. What they will say, I'm isolating stem cell from the patient and putting it back. So what is wrong? It is ethically not really correct because stem cell can also give rise to a cancer cell. Therefore, there's a lot of research that has to be understood. It is going on, there are conditional, as I said, only example that is here also is treatment of corneal disorder using limbal stem cells has been approved. So if you really look at this slide, only have been approved, only the classical bone marrow transplantation, which 26,000 patients are treated in Europe every year. The other example is this conditional approval is for the eye, and one conditional approval is for skin problem. If there is a chemical burn, recently received conditional approval. Everything else has not been approved at all. Even in India, we only say, in fact, there is a what we call as a DBT ICMR guideline, which says any stem cell therapy is only a clinical trial, should not be a clinical practice. But unfortunately, if you go to Delhi, there will be advertisements coming up saying, we can cure this, we can cure this, and people go, terminal cases do go, and they say, oh, I got benefit by 2 months, the family will say. So there is really no proof that stem cell has worked so far. For diseases which have not, other than bone marrow transplantation, maybe for the corneal thing, the international evidence is still being collected. It's not ready. Well, I talk about all this high science, now we still face a problem. Reinvent the toilet challenge. How do you, Swachh Bharat? If you really look, there's a lot of science possible here. You can see the type of projects we are looking at. Field test a solar-powered modular electronic toilet that is integrated with a mixed waste processing unit. Use of viral agents to kill pathogens, odor-producing bacteria and fecal waste. Viability of using ultrasound to reduce water use in toilets. A single household container that uses human feces to incubate black soldier fly larvae, which can be processed into marketable product. Concept of using fine sand-like material and an air blower to create a water-free toilet interface free of odor and flies. Design a septic tank that uses electrochemistry to reduce organic pollutants and improve the quality of discharge effluent. So when we put up this, because Bill Gates Foundation came up to Bayrak, and we put up, we got all these projects, much more. And these are probably 10% of the projects which have been selected. Therefore, there are brilliant people in this country, innovative thinking to take care of this. But what? I'll tell you the problem we have with all the science, with all the things that is possible. Because the problem I felt, the regulatory, we don't know about the regulatory issues are a major concern. I don't want to get into drug controller problem I have been facing for curcumin, which is a more natural molecule from turmeric. The National Biodiversity Authority says, you are using a natural product, you didn't take our permission. This is a turmeric which is being exported in tons abroad. Curcumin is being exported in tons. So many countries are using turmeric as well as curcumin. But now our biodiversity authority is asking whether you need permission to use this molecule. This is where our problems are, right from there. Are we ready for technology changes? I have different ideas on transgenic crops. I will not get into it. For example, in stem cell therapy, I told you we have only DBT-ICMR guideline. Meanwhile, there are cases where stem cell therapy is used as a clinical practice. It should not have been done. It's being done. Gene therapy, we don't have a guideline for gene therapy, a field which is there for 30 years. We are just trying to develop a regulatory system for gene therapy. Synthetic biology, it's a new area. Are we ready? Because we are still talking about regulatory issues, drug controller, classical methods of drug development. These are all new molecules. Synthetic biology, how do we regulate that? Medical devices, still recently there was a huge problem. Should we be simply getting a CE marking for commercialization? Who is there in the DCG office who will approve this medical device? It was not clear. Now they have formed some separate committees which will look at. DCG doesn't know how to handle cell therapy. The whole field of cell therapy, including stem cell therapy. Now they have formed a new committee. It's all less than a year old. The fields are all moving so fast. Agribiotech, I will not talk about it. So our regulatory problem is a huge dampener for many of these systems, actually. We have a long way to go. Keep pace with advancements. While we are still struggling, you have cyber security coming in a big way. It is a huge issue in big data analytics. Personalized data can be stored. You know, there are security issues have come. So one of the things that I'll just take 3-4 minutes and try to finish. To develop all this, the model has been, we have been looking at developing something in the academic community, then going after the industry. It has not worked actually. I feel the only way things will succeed is to co-development. You develop, if you have right idea, you have some proof of principle, get the industry right away. And that is where I think the startup concepts are very, very important, and I feel, of course, the government is already moving. There are 100 major laboratories in life science, which is an underestimate. I feel every CSR institute can have a dozen startups. Huge opportunities. Every ICR institute can have, universities can have startups. Related to the research they are doing, then the startups, you know, the one problem I'm finding is many of these institutions are looking at startups as a revenue model. These startups have no money, they have only ideas. You know, they're trying to charge them in rental, charge them for using the infrastructure. I don't think that is the way to go. The way to go would be to make it so cheap as easy as possible. Give them the infrastructure. We have all the infrastructure. If you go to a CSR lab or even an atomic energy laboratory, I think every infrastructure is available there. And these people hardly need one workbench. They have 2-3 people. And, you know, I think it is caught up. Now I find many labs have started. You may be surprised to recent news item carries the statement of Chinese minister for incentive to the effect that China would establish in 115 universities 1,600 incubators and support 80,000 startups. Whatever they think is in a different level altogether than what we are planning. But we really need a lot of startups. Basically, we need to co-develop systems, you know. Pilot plant manufacturing facilities is another problem. Why things are not moving. As I said, 400 projects are being supported. Many of them bright ideas. Come up to a pilot plant level, come up to prototype level. Then what will you do? Sir, manufacturing is not possible. I'm looking for licensing out. They will license it out to somebody. Most often it will go from somewhere abroad. And it will come in a totally different avatar afterwards. And you don't even recognize it as your technology. Unless we create that ecosystem to manufacture, we will not be able to do. I think that is where manufacturing regulation, these are the biggest problem. And government has to guarantee also certain products. Especially, for example, one example, H1N1 vaccine. There was a knee-jerk reaction. H1N1 causes mortality probably 100th what TB causes. But eventually we were pushed to make a vaccine. I pushed some of the companies, they made vaccine. By the time they made the vaccine, 3 months they made, H1N1 has disappeared. And no taker for the vaccine. And they said, sir, we have millions of doses of the vaccine lying with us, there is no buyer. That means government has to give a guarantee to these, otherwise their company next time they ask them, they won't make it. Why would they make it? Sorry. These are some of the issues. So we have critical mass with expertise is still lacking. Translation research is picking up, but investment is an issue. Innovation, definitely a lot of youngsters, bright ideas, no problem. Manufacturing, we need to go to manufacturing. Regulatory systems, I really don't know, sometimes feel like giving it up. It is still a major initiative, government initiative. I'm not seeing that much investment by the private sector. But the also I find a general lack of understanding of the whole field, actually. Many times I find people are not very clear. The moment you say DNA, etc., oh, this is something complex, something. It's not true. But at the same time, I want to tell you, innovation doesn't need all this big, big synthetic biology, biosystems biology. I just want to give you one example and close. SNT alone cannot solve the problem. A lack of a college degree or any engineering training didn't stop Mark Hoska, millions dying from reused needles, and doing something about it. The K1, as Hoska dubbed it, is equipped with a locking ring in the bottom of the barrel so that when the plunger is fully depressed, it stays there. Trying to pull the plunger back would snap the ring and effectively break the syringe. So he was the one who laid the foundation for non-reusable syringe. You cannot once use syringe. Of course, this is further improved. So he says, if I can do it, I don't have a degree, I have no, but I developed it and it was considered as one of the biggest innovations of the decade. He says, you can do it actually. Thank you so much. Yeah.